In this video, we will prepare the financial statements. We will need the adjusted trial balance for preparing the financial statements. From the adjusted trial balance, you're gonna use all the accounts and amounts that you have there and use them in the financial statements. There are four financial statements. There's the income statement, retained earnings statement, balance sheet, and cash flow statement. The last one, the cash flow statement, we're not gonna prepare that. Now we'll do that later because that's chapter 12. And what we will prepare today is the first three. They have to be prepared in a specific order. The first statement to prepare is the income statement. The second one has to be the retained earnings statement. And after that is the balance sheet. You cannot switch the order because it's not gonna work, and you will see in this video why it's not gonna work if you flip them in a different order. So your adjusted trial balance is the only resource for preparing those three. Because the adjusted trial balance has each and every account that we need for the statements. Okay, here's the adjusted trial balance. I pulled that from your textbook. So if it's not clear enough, you can always look back at your textbook. It's Exhibit 4.1 from Chapter 4. Okay, now remember, the first accounts that you will see in the adjusted trial balance are the asset accounts, so cash, accounts receivable, office supplies, prepaid rent, furniture, accumulated depreciation building, and accumulated depreciation for the building, land. Okay, so all the way until you get the land. Those are all asset accounts. After the assets, we have the liability accounts, accounts payable, utilities payable, salaries payable, interest payable, unearned revenue, notes payable. Those are all liabilities. They have credit balance, okay? And then after that, we have the common stock, dividends, service revenue. So the common stock dividends, those are considered equity accounts. And then we start with revenue accounts, which is service revenue. We just have one account for the revenue. And then we have a couple of expense accounts. We got rent expense, salaries expense, supplies expense, utilities expense, depreciation expense for furniture, depreciation expense for building, interest expense. Those are all, they all have debit balance for all the expenses. Now, the first statement to prepare is the income statement. The income statement it's just for showing how much profit or how much income the company is making. How do we calculate that? We have to look at the revenues and the expenses. That's it. Revenues and expenses. Only revenues and expenses for the income statement. It's not so complicated because revenue shows how much money or how much cash we're gonna earn or we earned, sorry, how much cash we earned within that specific period of time. And then we will subtract from the revenues the expenses, which is the cash that we paid for operating the business, okay? So revenue, which is what we earn, expenses, it's what we paid, the input minus the output that shows us the net income or the net profit that the company makes. Revenues minus expenses, the cash in minus the cash out. So I just need to look at the bottom part and the adjusted trial balance, starting from the service revenue all the way down to the interest expense, okay? Only revenues and expenses. I only need those accounts for the income statement, okay? We've got $17,500 for the revenue, $3,000 for expense, and so on. I just need to copy these amounts. There's no adding or subtracting when you prepare the financial statements. You just have to copy these amounts into the income statement. Okay, so here's the income statement. You always have to start with the revenue. So service revenue was $17,500. We got that amount from the adjusted trial balance. And then all the expenses lined up under each other with the same amounts that we had in the adjusted trial balance. And then the total expenses was 89.50, which is the total of all these expenses. Subtract the 89.50 from the 17,500. That's 8,550, which is the net income. That's the net profit. The company earned 17,500 and they paid 89.50, or they incurred expenses 89.50. So the net income was 8,550. Okay. The other thing you need to know is that the income statement usually represents a period of time. It doesn't represent the performance of the company since they started. It represents only the last, period of time. Usually it's a month. Most of the time it's a month. For some reason, the example we have here, which I pulled from the textbook, it shows the performance the last 2 months of 2016, but usually it's about a month, or sometimes it's just 1 year that combines everything, all the revenues and expenses that happen in a specific year. In our example here, it says 2 months ended December 31st. That's how usually they explain it in the title. 2 months means from between November 1st all the way until December 31st. So every revenue and expense that shows up here in the income statement shows the total revenue that happened between November 1st and December 31st, and the expenses, same thing, between November 1st and December 31st. If it was just a month, let's say a month of December, then it would be representing December 1st all the way until December 31st. All right, now this is how we prepare. So the company made $8,550 profit or net income the last 2 months of 2016. Now, the next, so that's how you prepare the income statement. The next statement is the retained earnings. The retained earnings, it's called the retained earnings because it shows what portion of the net income that hasn't been distributed to the owners. It hasn't been distributed as dividends. So to calculate the retained earnings, you need to find out how much net income the company made, subtract from that the dividends that has been distributed to the owners, and that shows you how much remaining balance out of the net income that stays in the company. It's retained to the company. It's as if you're giving your company a portion of the net income. And that's probably because they want to expand the business in future. They have some plans in future. That's why they're keeping a portion of the profit. They're not distributing the whole thing. So here's the retained earnings statement. The first line shows the retained earnings November 1st, 2016. So remember, the retained earnings, it's like the income statement in terms of representation. It represents a period of time as well. So it also represents the last 2 months of 2016, so November and December. So the first line shows the retained earnings November 1st, which is the beginning balance at the beginning of that specific period of time. It used to be zero. That means there was no any retained earnings before in the previous periods. And then this particular period, which is the last 2 months of 2016, they had net income of 8,550. Now, where did we get that amount from? Go back to the income statement. That's the amount we got over here in the income statement. It's the same amount. I'm just copying it in the retained earnings. So now you know why retained earnings statement has to be prepared after the income statement. You cannot do the income statement after the retained earnings because we need that 8,850 to be taken from income statement and show it in the retained earnings. So we add that net income to the beginning balance of retained earnings, and then we subtract the dividends, which is $5,000 in our example. How did we know it's $5,000 dividends? Go back to the trial balance. Here's the trial balance. We had dividends of $5,000. Remember, your trial balance is your main resource for preparing the financial statements. So subtract the $5,000 dividends from the net income and add that to the retained earning beginning balance, and that gives you retained earnings beginning ending balance at the end of this period, which is December 31st, which ends up on December 31st. So zero plus 8,550 minus $5,000 dividends equals $3,550. So your balance of return earnings at the end of December is $3,550. It used to be zero, now it increased from zero to $3,550. Now the next step is to prepare the next statement, which is the balance sheet. The balance sheet is very similar to the accounting equation. It has the assets, liabilities, stockholders' equity. Under the assets, we're gonna show each and every asset account. Where do we get those from? We get them from the adjusted triad balance. Remember, that's your main resource. So we're gonna go back to the adjusted triad balance, and then we will look at cash, accounts receivable, office supplies, prepaid, all the way down until land. Look at the balances. We've got debit balance for all of them except the accumulated depreciation they had, credit balance. So $12,200 for cash and $1,800 for accounts receivable and so on. Just copy all these amounts and accounts into the balance sheet under the assets. We just copied them. Here's everything. All right. And then you add up all your assets, which includes the credit balance for the accumulated depreciation, which is technically, those balances technically need to be subtracted from your assets. And then you end up with a total assets of $113,550. That's on the asset side. And remember that on the other side, liabilities and equity, once you add those together, the amount has to equal the total assets. So let's see. Liabilities, go back to the trial balance. Here's all the liabilities. Accounts payable, utilities payable, salaries payable, all the way down until notes payable. We've got credit balance for all of them, $200, $100, $1,200. Just copy all those to the balance sheet here under liabilities. And then you got your total liabilities, $62,000. So you're going to show the total liabilities separate. And then your total equity separate. Okay. So equity, it has the common stock, which is $48,000. We take that from the adjusted trial balance. And then underneath it, we have the retained earnings. So that's something new that we're learning today. It's the retained earnings. It's an equity account. It goes under the stockholders' equity. And then where do we get that balance from? The $3,550? From the retained earnings statement, $3,550. We go back. So now you know why the balance sheet has to be prepared after the retained earnings statement, which is because we need that balance. We need it in the balance sheet. $3,550 goes here, all right? So add your common stock plus retained earnings. That gives you the total equity, which is $51,550. Add that balance to the liabilities of $62,000. You get $113,550, which is the total liabilities plus stockholders' equity. That balance is matching with total assets, which is great. Our numbers are out of balance, and most probably there's no mistake. Now, remember, do we see revenues and expenses in the balance sheet? The answer is no. So they're not revenues and expenses. They are not a balance sheet accounts. However, they do reflect indirectly on the balance sheet under the equity side. They do reflect on the equity side. How did we know that? Well, under the equity, we have retained earnings. Where did the retained earning came from? It came from net income and dividends. We put them together and we came up with the balance. So where did the net income come from? It came from revenues minus expenses. So the retained earnings balance, $3,550, it shows the net balance of the net income minus the dividends all together. So revenues, expenses, and dividends, all of them combined in one balance, which is the $3,550. So let's think about something. What would happen if we had more revenues during that period? What will happen to the total equity? Or what will happen to the retained earnings balance under the stockholders' equity in the balance sheet? If we had more revenue, that means, more revenue is assuming that everything else did not change, like expenses and dividends. So if we had more revenues, that means our net income will increase. Well, if the net income increases, that means in our retained earnings statement, that balance will be higher, which is the net income, which will make our ending balance retained earnings also higher because of the increase in net income. So if my retained earnings was higher, that means in our balance sheet, the retained earnings balance will be higher as well. So more revenues means more retained earnings in the balance sheet means more equity. What would happen if our expenses were higher or the dividends were higher? Go back to the income statement. If we had more expenses, that means we would end up with less net income. If we had less net income, that means we will end up with less retained earnings balance in the retained earnings statement. Or if our dividends were higher, that means we're going to subtract a higher amount from the net income, which will make our ending balance retained earnings also lower. So in the balance sheet, if you had higher expenses or higher dividends, that means your retained earnings balance would be lower under the equity. But if you had more revenues, then your retained earnings will be higher, okay? More revenue, more retained earning. More expenses or dividends, less retained earnings and less equity in the balance sheet, okay? So that tells us how the statements are connected with each other, how all the three financial statements, income statement, retained earning, and balance sheet, they're connected in somehow. Even if you don't see the dividends, revenues, and expenses in the balance sheet, they still reflect indirectly on the balances in the balance sheet, all right? The last thing we want to look at here is also the balance sheet, but this one is classified balance sheet. The balances are not going to be different from the balance sheet that we've just seen, but it's just more detailed. So let's see. Under the assets, we have the current assets, and then the plant assets, or sometimes they call them the fixed assets. But the total assets is $113,550. It's not different. It's just that we're going to classify every group of asset accounts in a subgroup. So current assets means the short-term assets. It means that any asset that can be converted to cash within a year or less, like cash, receivable, office supplies, prepaid rent. Okay, so the total current assets is 16,100, and then the plant assets or the fixed assets, it's the long-term assets. Long-term assets means that assets that will stay longer than a year, and they do not normally change, convert to cash within less than a year. So furniture, building, land. Okay, then the total plant assets is 97,450. Add that to the current assets, that gives you the total assets. Liabilities, same thing. We're going to have the current liabilities and the long-term liabilities. Anything that can be converted to cash within less than a year, that will be current. Anything longer than a year, that will be long-term, okay? But you still have the same total liabilities, and the total liabilities plus equity will also be 113,550. It's not going to be different, okay? So that's all for this video. Now we know how to prepare the financial statements. In the next video, we'll talk about the last step in our accounting cycle, which is the closing entries.